Vamos a iniciar nuestra mesa redonda en donde tendremos una conferencia del profesor Karl Bautenbacher. La mesa, como ven ustedes, la composición de la mesa va a ser dirigida por la doctora Eliana Rodríguez. Va a ser una exposición el profesor Bautenbacher de aproximadamente 30 a 45 minutos. Después vamos a hacer una pequeña reseña en español de lo que se dice y después vamos a dar la palabra a los comentaristas en una exposición que va a ser de 10 o 15 minutos. Me permito entonces leer la reseña curricular de la doctora Eliana Rodríguez. Ella obtuvo en esta universidad mención honorífica en tres ocasiones. La primera por el título de licenciatura en Derecho, la segunda por la maestría en Relaciones Internacionales y la tercera en el grado doctoral en Derecho con investigación en el campo de Derecho Internacional. Tiene una larga trayectoria, solamente voy a dar algunos de los puntos fundamentales de su currículum. Es miembro del Sistema Nacional de Investigadores, es también profesora de Ciencias Políticas, es miembro de nuestro cuerpo de investigación de la línea de Estado de Derecho Internacional en la etapa de Fuente de Derecho Internacional, y además, si no fuera suficiente todas esas actividades, ella ha dirigido programas en televisión, por eso es muy, muy conocida en este programa El Observador, ¿sí? Internacional, que ya no existe en el Canal 22, pero después platicamos sobre eso. Entonces tenemos el suerte y el honor de que ella dirija nuestra mesa. Empezamos, tratamos de cumplir con los tiempos, porque estamos con europeos, así es que...
Bueno, pues muy buenos días a todos. Agradecemos su amable presencia. En principio, agradecer a las autoridades del Instituto y al organizador Manuel Becerra, a los presentes y, por supuesto, a nuestro invitado de honor, el doctor Karl Bautenbacher, que esté en este evento. Voy a dar lectura al currículum del doctor Karl Bautenbacher. Él es profesor, doctor en Derecho, pero doctor también en Política y Economía, con mención honorífica o lo que es honoris causa. Él es presidente del Tribunal de la Asociación Europea de Libre Comercio, conocida por sus iniciales EFTA, que son su acrónimo en inglés, desde el 2003. Y también, por supuesto, juez desde 1995. El Tribunal del EFTA es competente para decidir los casos relativos a los estados de la Asociación Europea de Libre Comercio, que son Islandia, Liechtenstein y Noruega, en el marco del Acuerdo sobre el Espacio Económico Europeo, que es el EEA Agreement en inglés. El EEA Agreement ha ampliado las libertades fundamentales, la competencia y las ayudas estatales de la Unión Europea y gran parte de la legislación secundaria a los tres estados. Es director del Centro de Derecho Europeo y Derecho Internacional de la Universidad de St. Gallen, en Suiza, fundador y director del Máster de Posgrado del Programa Ejecutivo de Europa y Derecho Comercial Internacional en la misma universidad. Es fundador y presidente del concurso del Foro de Derecho Internacional de St. Gallen, es copresidente del Foro Internacional de la Energía, imparte la Cátedra de Derecho Privado, Comercial y Económico en la Universidad de St. Gallen de 1987 al 2013, profesor visitante permanente de la Universidad de Texas en Austin en la Escuela de Derecho, miembro de la Corte Suprema de Justicia del Principado Liechtenstein de 1994 a 95, profesor invitado de la Universidad de Ginebra en 1991, autor de más de 40 libros y 200 artículos, principalmente en las áreas de derecho contractual, derecho de sociedades, derecho de la competencia y antimonopolio desleal, derecho de propiedad intelectual, el derecho de resolución de conflictos, adjudicación judicial y arbitraje, legislación de la Unión Europea y del Espacio Económico Europeo en general y derecho de la globalización. El siguiente currículum de los presentes es precisamente el del doctor Manuel Becerra Ramírez. Es licenciado en Derecho por la Facultad de Derecho de la UNAM. Tiene estudios de doctorado en la División de Estudios Superiores de la Facultad de Derecho de esta institución, con especialidad en Derecho Constitucional y Administrativo. Es también doctor en Derecho Internacional por la Universidad Estatal Lomonosov de Moscú en la ex Unión de Repúblicas Socialistas Soviéticas URSS. Título adquirido después de la defensa de la tesis México y el Nuevo Orden Económico Internacional, aspectos jurídicos, que lo hizo en idioma ruso. Realizado bajo la dirección del profesor Gregory E. Tunkin. Ha sido profesor visitante en las universidades de Emory, Atlanta, de California, Los Ángeles, de La Habana, Cuba, de Ottawa, Canadá, de Oxford, Inglaterra, y la Universidad de Buenos Aires. Fue coordinador del programa de posgrado de Derecho de la UNAM de 2001 al 2003. Es investigador titular C de tiempo completo en el Instituto de Investigaciones Jurídicas de la UNAM desde 1985. Miembro del Sistema Nacional de Investigadores, nivel 3, de la Universidad Nacional, lo reconocen por el PRI de nivel D. Es profesor de las asignaturas de Derecho Internacional y Derecho de la Propiedad Intelectual. Es también director del Anuario Mexicano de Derecho Internacional. Sus áreas de investigación son el Derecho Internacional Público y el Derecho Internacional de la Propiedad Intelectual. El profesor Sergio Peña Neira, profesor e investigador de la Universidad Bernardo O'Higgins, miembro de la Sociedad Chilena de Derecho Internacional, licenciado en Ciencias Jurídicas, licenciado y magíster en Relaciones Internacionales y Europeas, diplomado en Estudios Avanzados en Ciencias Jurídicas y doctor de la Universidad de Huelva, Andalucía, España, sobresaliente por mayoría. Tiene un diploma predoctoral de la Universidad de Naciones Unidas en Tokio, así como estudios doctorales en Bélgica e investigaciones en Alemania, España y Canadá. Es miembro del equipo investigador del proyecto de investigación sobre Estado de Derecho Internacional que preside el doctor Manuel Becerra. También está con nosotros el doctor Tomás Milton Muñoz Bravo. Él es maestro en Estudios y Relaciones Internacionales, doctor en Ciencias Políticas y Sociales por la UNAM. Ha realizado estancias de investigación en universidades de Buenos Aires, en la Facultad de Ciencias Políticas y Sociales de la UNAM y en el Tecnológico de Monterrey, Campus Puebla. Participó como profesor de cátedra. Es autor de varios artículos en materia económica y materia de integración, así como trata y tráfico de personas. También está con nosotros, a la izquierda, el maestro Rodolfo Cruz Miramontes. Él también tiene un currículo muy extenso, estoy tratando de abreviar lo más que puedo. Él es licenciado en Derecho por la UNAM, es doctor en Derecho por la Universidad de Madrid. Tiene cursos especializados en Derecho Internacional en Francia, tiene cursos especializados en Derecho Internacional en La Haya, Holanda, tiene una extensa experiencia académica desde 1975 en materia marítima de comercio exterior, de legislación de comercio internacional en distintas universidades, donde ha participado en, por ejemplo, Luxemburgo, Austria, Río de Janeiro, en Brasil, en Ottawa, en Bogotá, en Madrid y en diferentes ciudades de América Latina. Tiene diversas publicaciones, entre las más relevantes, las relaciones comerciales multilaterales de México y el Tratado Libre Comercio, el Tratado Libre Comercio, controversias, soluciones y otros temas, legislación restrictiva de comercio internacional, México y la Unión Europea. Participa en muchas asociaciones, pero mencionaré una de las más importantes, que es la International Law Association. Agradecemos mucho la presencia de los participantes. And then we will ask Professor Bodenbacher if you can say some words and also present your speech, please. Go on.
Should I do it here?
Yeah. Would you like to stay there or you want to go there?
I'll go over there.
Okay, thank you.
Good morning. Profesor Iliana Rodríguez, Profesor Manuel Becerra Ramírez, Dr. Pedro Salazar, Dr. Francisco Ibarra, Your Excellency Merete Nergard, Embajadora de Noruega, y Your Excellency, I don't know your first name, Mr. Zulav, Chargé d'Affaires de la Confederación Helvética. Es un gran honor y placer para mí de hablar en esta universidad prestigiosa sobre el sistema de los dos pilares en Europa y sobre la idea de establecer un sistema similar en América Latina. However, my Spanish is not that good, so that I have to switch to the lingua franca of globalization, which is English. But I will, and I'm prepared to take questions in Spanish. There are two important languages, the most important languages in the world. It's English and Spanish. And while coming here, my wife Doris, who accompanied me, a doctor in economics, and I made a tour via my old university, the University of Texas, in Austin. And I was reminded that the first woman governor in Texas history was Miriam Ma Ferguson, who in the 1920s became governor of Texas under adventurous circumstances. And she was allegedly once asked whether she thought that it was a good idea that Texas college students had to study Spanish. And she allegedly answered, "Why on earth should they study Spanish if English was good enough for Jesus Christ?" So English must be good enough for you. Let me start with some history. The project of a large Western European free trade zone started in the 1950s. In 1952, the European Coal and Steel Community was established, and those who were not part of that community feared a split in Europe. And from 1956 on, Switzerland and the United Kingdom tried to avoid this split. They promoted the idea of a wide free trade zone within OEEC. These efforts were reinforced after the conclusion of the Rome Treaty, the EEC Treaty in 1957, but the negotiations broke down due to French resistance. In 1960, the multilateral EFTA Convention was concluded with Austria, Denmark, Norway, Portugal, Sweden, Switzerland, and the United Kingdom. EFTA is a free trade area which has eliminated customs duties on industrial products. Each EFTA state retains its foreign trade sovereignty and therefore has its own customs duty regime vis-à-vis third countries. EFTA has no competence to enact legislation. There's no common surveillance and no common court in EFTA as such, not to be compared with the EFTA pillar of the European Economic Area, and membership can easily be terminated. So after 1960, there were two economic blocs in Europe, the EEC on the one side, the Inner Six, as they were called from a geographic point of view, and the Outer Seven, the EFTA member states. A customs union stood versus a free trade area, and membership in both blocs was frequently changing, but the EEC over the years proved to be more attractive. So the question was asked, is EFTA just a waiting room for a better solution, or is EFTA an own model of integration? For a long time, the answer was it is a waiting room for the better solution, but in recent years, people have started to think about EFTA 2.0, about an alternative structure to the European Union, which would still guarantee a functioning single market, but be without the political goal. Now, in light of later developments, it is quite interesting to say a word on the association negotiations of Austria, Sweden, and Switzerland with the European Economic Community in the early 1960s. Only after 1 year, the UK applied to join the European Economic Community, and Denmark and Norway, both NATO members, had similar thoughts, so that the three neutral EFTA states felt compelled to react. The Austrian, Swedes, and Swiss started negotiations with the European Economic Community, and the issues discussed at the time were quite similar to the ones under the EEA. For instance, what about securing homogeneity of the law? What about the form of participation of the EFTA states in EEC legislation? It was said that a surveillance mechanism was needed. Somebody had to have the competence to give interpretation to the law. The question was discussed, what would happen if an EFTA state refused to take over new EEC law. And with regard to surveillance and judicial control, three models were discussed at the time, either to give the competence to the Commission and the jurisdiction to the ECJ, or to give the competence to an association council, or to give the competence and jurisdiction to national organs. Nobody at the time spoke of an EFTA surveillance authority and of an EFTA court. Now, French President Charles de Gaulle blocked the British attempt to join the EEC in 1963, and then these association negotiations were terminated. Last point in my brief historical overview is the EEA agreement. In the years 1994 and 95, six of the then seven EFTA states were linked to the EU by way of the EEA agreement, a comprehensive association agreement. Switzerland is not part of this agreement. And three of these EFTA states then switched sides. I will come back to that. A two-pillar system was established with separate legal orders and separate organs, but largely identical law in substance, and with two legal cultures, not to be overlooked. A Franco-German-dominated legal culture in the European Union, with some common law elements due to British and Irish accession in 1972, but still largely French-dominated, and an Anglo-Nordic-Swiss legal culture in EFTA. Now, since the law is identical, but there are different organs, the fundamental problems was from the beginning, from the viewpoint of businesses and of citizens. How can you secure a level playing field? This is how the situation looked like in 1994. The EC with 12 member states at the time, surveillance in the hand of the Commission with 12 commissioners, the EEA EFTA with five member states at the time, surveillance in the hands of ESA, the EFTA Surveillance Authority, with five college members. As far as the courts are concerned, the ECJ with 12 judges at the time and six advocates general, the EFTA court with five judges, no advocate general, and not to forget that also the national courts in both pillars were at the same time national courts and European courts. Now, in the time since 1994, the situation has quite changed as far as the size of those two pillars is concerned. The EU, meanwhile, consists of 28 member states, which means that the Commission has 28 commissioners, one from each member state. The EEA EFTA is down to three member states with Iceland, Liechtenstein and Norway, as the chairwoman said. EFTA Surveillance Authority with three college members. The ECJ with 28 judges and nine advocates general, and the EFTA court with three judges plus the national courts. Now, three judges is not much, but that doesn't mean that we don't have our own voice and we don't have our own power of the pen. And my experience is that in certain respects, it is even an advantage to be small, in particular when it comes to maintaining the coherence of your case law and when it comes to being quick. Second chapter of my speech, peculiarities in the EEA, in this European two-pillar system due to the difference in size and power. On the legislative level, this difference in size and power had quite a consequence because EEA law originates from EU law and the EFTA states do have a co-determination right but no co-decision right. They do participate in decision shaping at the expert level but not in the decision making. On the political level, one method which has emerged in the last years in order to mitigate a little bit this disadvantage was that certain EFTA states have started to contest the EEA relevance of a new legislative act, but that goes at the cost of homogeneity. So at the end of the day, I think it's understandable that in particular politicians and diplomats complain about this situation where the EFTA states have to adopt new EEA law without having a full co-decision right. But on the judicial level, the situation looks a bit different. As far as the law on the books is concerned, we also have the situation that the EFTA court follows the ECJ. But when it comes to the law in action, and I will come back to that, the situation is quite different. As far as the law in action is concerned, in most of our cases, we have to go first. That means the EFTA court has to answer legal questions which have not been before the ECJ so far. And most importantly, homogeneity is no snapshot in time. Cannot be understood as a snapshot in time. It must be looked at in the long run. It is a process-oriented concept. And I will come back to that when talking about cases. Now, to guarantee a level playing field, homogeneity rules were agreed on. In the first version of the EEA agreement, Article 6 said, if provisions in EEA law and in EU law are identical in substance to the provisions of the European, are identical in substance, then they shall be interpreted in conformity with the relevant rulings of the European Court of Justice, as far as they have been given prior to the date of signature of this agreement. That means, with regard to old case law, the EFTA court shall follow. There was another provision at this time. That is Article 3 of the treaty between the EFTA states on the establishment of a surveillance authority and a court. And there it is stated, as far as new case law is concerned, case law rendered after the date of the signature of the agreement, the EFTA's surveillance authority and the EFTA court shall pay due account to the case law of the ECJ. Due account means less than follow, but yet in practice, if you are supposed to be homogeneous, this cannot be decisive. Also, in the first version of the EA agreement, there was also an obligation on the ECJ to take into due account the case law of the then planned EEA court, but the ECJ didn't like this, and so it rejected this obligation in its famous, and some people say infamous, opinion 191. In the final version of the EEA agreement, Article 6, has remained unaltered. Article 3, paragraph 2 of the Surveillance and Court Agreement has remained unaltered, but this Article 104, which would have obliged the ECJ to take into account the case law of the other side, was deleted. In practice, we have seen since 1994 a development which one could describe from one-way street homogeneity to judicial dialogue. Only for the sake of order, I mentioned that there are other mechanisms also in place in this two-pillar system in Europe, which shall contribute to the homogeneous development of the case law. The right to make submissions and interventions on both sides. The Commission comes to our oral hearings. The ESA goes to the oral hearings of the ECJ. The information exchange system, which is not that important anymore today as in 1994, because we have the internet. And as an ultima ratio, a dispute resolution mechanism, which has never been invoked so far. Now, this leads me now to the question of the day, to the question of whether this model could be exported in a way to Latin America by the establishment of an Espacio Económico de América Latina. Now, if I start to think about that, I should say that I have discussed this idea with the president of the Tribunal de Justicia de la Comunidad Andina, el profesor Luis Diez Canseco. And we are planning to set up a conference in Lima on this subject in the spring. If such an espacio could be set up between the Andean community and Mercosur, It is in my view clear that it would have been, it would have to be a full-fledged two-pillar model. That means with equal rights and equal co-decision rights on both sides. There are, however, as we all know, different degrees of judicialization and institutionalization of the law in both pillars. And I already call them pillars now, in Mercosur on the one hand and in the Comunidad Andina. Andean law is more judicialized than Mercosur law, and the Andean community has stronger structures than Mercosur, but that's no hindrance. And the European experience proves that this is not a hindrance, because the EFTA pillar has slightly weaker structures than the EU pillar. Namely, there is no written obligation to make a reference on a national court of last resort in the EFTA pillar to the EFTA court, and there is no direct effect in the EFTA pillar, unlike in the EU pillar, and this has not hindered this two-pillar system from functioning very well over the last 22 years. So in a Latin American espacio, the homogeneity rules would have to be fully reciprocal. Talking about homogeneity rules, I think that one would have to discuss about a duty on both sides to take into account old and new case law of the other courts. One would have to think about guaranteeing a right to make submissions and interventions to any kind of surveillance authorities in both pillars. I cannot see that there is such an authority in Mercosur right now, but who knows. An information system would be indispensable, and one could think of having, at the end of the day, as ultima ratio, a dispute resolution mechanism. Let me then share some thoughts on the framework conditions of judges. This is of judging in such an international set up or supranational, that's a matter of taste, but I know that the Brazilians don't like to hear supranational, so I stick to international here. This is based on my own 20 years experience on the EFTA bench. The most crucial conditions for such a two-pillar system to function is that the judges have high qualifications, that they have full independence and impartiality, which means no political appointees, and that this independence and impartiality and the qualification and the competence must be scrutinized before people are appointed to the bench by a panel, for instance, be it at the national level, as it happens in EFTA, or on the higher, on the European level, as it happens in the European Union. As far as methods of interpretation are concerned, which is the A and O of lawyering, one would have to think about which basic method should prevail. Is it effe utile, el principio de la efectividad, or should it be the interpretation rules of the Vienna Convention, which are rather conservative? I think the Andean Court of Justice sticks to el principio de la efectividad. One has to bear in mind that there may be gaps in the texts and that many provisions are open textured. If you take a provision such as measures having equivalent effect to import restrictions, that's an open texture provision which by definition needs interpretation. And then, and in my view and in light of my experience, one has to address the non-legal factors of interpretation. Many of our lawyers and law professors still teach the students that in interpretation, the text is important, the scheme, the purpose, the history, and so on. But at least as important as those legal factors are the non-legal factors. And there I would name three. First, the attitude or the pre-understanding of the judge. which always plays a role. It doesn't go away, but it's good if judges are aware of it. And if one judge is getting too biased and sticking to his personal beliefs, then the other judges are under an obligation to tell their colleague about this. Then second point, whether a judge pursues strategic goals with his or her voting. Also, this cannot be excluded. And most importantly, in international courts, it is not a given that judges stick to institutional loyalty. There is always a certain danger that international judges look back to their capital when they decide a case and do it in view of what they think is the wish of the government which has nominated it. And then not least in light of the fact that there may be a reappointment system and that such a judge may fear that if he doesn't do it or she doesn't do it that way, reappointment may be at risk. So institutional loyalty would translate into Spanish as lealtad institucional. I cannot go into all the areas of a possible espacio económico, but let me just focus on what I would call institutional convergence. First message, structures and institutions matter. They are important for guaranteeing legal certainty. Those who are subject to a given law must be able to plan and regulate their conduct in advance. They must be able to predict with reasonable certainty what the outcome of a court or arbitration case would be. They must be able to avoid conduct which will cause them damage. And at the end of the day, the law is all about predicting. And this must be borne in mind. And on that point, clearly, courts have an advantage over political resolution bodies. Legal certainty must be guaranteed with regard to all the actions of public authorities, also in private relationships. It's an issue, I just mentioned that for the sake of order. Legal certainty is part of the rule of law. In European law, both in EFTA and the EU, it's a general principle of law. And change of practice is a problem. Overruling established case law is a problem. No matter whether we have a precedent system like in the common law or a system like in the civil law, changing practice cannot be easily. In one way or the other, some sort of a precedent system is needed. What then is the role of courts, if I want to be a little bit more specific on that? I already said that the principle of effectiveness is important. The role of dynamic interpretation. Dynamism, however, stands versus legal certainty. Legal certainty may stand versus justice. Maybe that an answer by a court enhances legal certainty, but it's unfair. Then we would have illegal certainty or unlawful certainty. What you need, in my view, is that the courts contribute to the protection of investment, the protection of IP rights, but within reasonable limits, no eternal patents, no eternal copyright. And also with regard to trademark, one should not exaggerate. Investment and human rights are an issue which need to be discussed. The market freedoms are of fundamental importance. And in my view, also, if you take the Andean community, it's quite clear that they cannot function without a strong competition law. State aid control is a European invention, which I highly recommend also to other parts of the world. And then we would have the harmonized law. And in Latin America, since the structures so far have been far from each other, one should probably focus in particular also on mechanisms such as mutual recognition and convergence, which means rather soft mechanisms, which can, however, be very effective. Let me then turn to some case studies, and I take those case studies from the EEA, which means from the European two-pillar system, but I hope that you can see how this could function in practice. I said before, homogeneity is a process, not a snapshot in time. And the goal must always be homogeneity, whether it is El Espacio or the European two-pillar model. Homogeneity should be the result of a dialogue of the courts and the actors in the European EEAR, the EFTA Court, the ECJ and the General Court of the European Union, the national courts of the EEAEFTA states, the national courts of the EU member states, the European Commission, the EFTA Surveillance Authority, ESA, the governments in both pillars, the citizens and economic operators in both pillars, and la doctrine, that means academic teaching, academic literature, and the public at large. A important case, one of the most important judgments of the EFTA Court concerned the question of whether a government can ban the marketing of food which has been fortified with vitamin and iron. That was the Norwegian Kellogg's case. Here, the EFTA Court faced the situation that in 1983, the ECJ had in a similar case given judgment and said, we do accept the nutritional need argument. If a government can show that there is no nutritional need for such a fortification in the country, we do, as a matter of principle, accept that. That was a little bit of a paternalistic approach. Now, then things developed, WTO law developed, and there was the Commission communication on the precautionary principle of 2000. And in 2001, the EFTA Court was faced with the question of whether Norway could ban the marketing of Kellogg's cornflakes, which had been fortified with vitamins and with iron. And the Norwegian government invoked the nutritional need argument, and we rejected it. We did not follow the ECJ. So that was a kind of a dialectic dialogue. And we set out in the judgment why we didn't follow it. However, we did recognize the precautionary principle. That also was invoked by the Norwegian government. But we said that you can invoke the precautionary principle only if certain conditions are fulfilled. And these conditions were largely taken from WTO law and from the Commission's communication. And the Norwegian government failed on these conditions, in particular because they had not carried out a proper risk assessment, firstly, and secondly, their policy as a whole was inconsistent because they claimed that giving Kellogg's cornflakes to the Norwegian population could cause harm since it had been fortified with iron, but at the same time the Norwegian government had given a piece of goat cheese every morning to the school children, which was also fortified with iron, so that at the end of the day the measure failed because it was deemed to be inconsistent. And this is now very interesting from a judicial dialogue standpoint, that when the ECJ was faced with a very similar case only 2 years later, it overruled its old case law and followed us. The Advocate General had said, no, no, you shouldn't have followed them on the nutritional need, but they did. And the Commission, in pleading its case in the ECJ, said that there are almost 20 years in between. There has been development in between. The EFTA Court has it right. You should follow the EFTA Court here. And so it happened. And there were other ECJ cases, and the General Court were all on that line. Second example of how such a dialogue may evolve. Under European law, that's different from the United States, apparel importers have basically the right to open the outer packaging of pharmaceuticals, to take the blister stripes out, to repackage them, and to put their name on the box, and some other conditions must be fulfilled, and then to sell these products at a lower price. Now, in this Merck versus Paranova case, the repackager Paranova did not limit itself to repackaging, but they added their own design. You can see it here on the slide. They took the two color stripes from the middle of the box on the left and moved them out to the edges of their own box. And this they did with all the pharmaceuticals. In the case of Merck, the colors were green and black. In the case of Novartis, the colors were yellow and black. And in the case of others, probably red and black. And by doing this, they created their own product range. And the ECJ had already been faced with this problem before us, but left the question open. And when we had given judgment, the England and Wales Court of Appeal, a court in the EU pillar, referred the question to the ECJ, what now? Do you side with the EFTA court? Or do you side with certain national Supreme Courts in the European Union, such as the German Supreme Court, and I think also the Austrian Supreme Court? And the ECJ did, in fact, follow us here, and so had the Advocate General. And then the German Supreme Court did the same. Another example of how such a dialogue can go, and that homogeneity can never be understood as a snapshot in time. Next example concerns the scope of antitrust immunity of collective agreements. In basically every jurisdiction in the world, collective agreements, that means agreements negotiated between the labor unions and the employers, are exempt from the application of the antitrust rules. And ECJ said in this Albany case in 1999, yes, they are immune, full stop, without going into the question of whether certain provisions in the collective agreement could be overshooting so that they would be caught by the antitrust rules. The Advocate General of the ECJ at the time, the British Francis Jacobs, one of the big minds there, he elaborated on the limitations of this immunity in his opinion. And when my court was called upon to rule on this issue in the Landsorganisationen case, a Norwegian case, we followed the Advocate General and said, yes, basically immune, but not everything. And then another Advocate General, Portuguese, Boyares Maduro, in the Viking Line case, followed us on this. Interestingly, the long-standing president of the ECJ, who just left office 3 weeks ago, Vasilios Kouris, in extrajudicial writing, followed also us, or said that was an important contribution to homogeneity and many EU commentators. The question is open whether the ECJ would follow us, but we will have a new chance now in this whole ship Norge case, which has been referred by the Norwegian Supreme Court to us. Oral hearing will take place in 2 weeks. This case has a special background because there had been a conflict between the Norwegian Supreme Court and the EFTA Court, because the Norwegian Supreme Court had not made a reference to us in 13 years. And I had given an interview or written an article in a Norwegian law journal, which the journalists of the largest newspaper picked up and put the title there, Frontalangrep, Pahoyesteret. I don't think I have to translate that. Now, my next example concerns the standard of judicial review in antitrust law. This is one of the crucial issues in European antitrust law. You may know that in the United States, there is basically full review on the merits in antitrust cases. But in Europe, it used to be quite different. The traditional line in the European Union was limited review, in particular of complex economic and technical assessments. This was summarized by the General Court in the famous Microsoft judgment in 2007. And what is then a complex economic and technical assessment? For instance, the question of how the relevant market must be defined, the question of whether a competitor has dominant market power, the question of whether this dominant market power has been abused, the question of whether smaller competitors have been foreclosed, whether competition has been foreclosed, and so on. This issue has been taken up by the business lawyers and in-house counsel because the fines have increased so tremendously. We now are seeing antitrust fines in Europe which go to the hundreds of millions of euros or even billions of euros. And so these lawyers have started to argue that the European Union and EFTA should switch from an inquisitorial to a prosecutorial enforcement system in competition law, like in the United States, where the competition authority only investigates the case and then must take the firms to court. In Europe, now they do investigate and take the decision, and then the firm must take the authority to court. Now, in the Menarini case, the European Court of Human Rights, and here you see that the situation in Europe is even more complicated because there's a third player. The European Court of Human Rights said, we accept this European enforcement system with a competition authority investigating and taking the decision, provided that there is a court which exercises full review. And the ECJ then, in two cases, still in one way or the other, stuck to the idea of limited review. But the EFTA court in Norway Post then said quite clearly, it must be full review, and we must also review complex economic assessments. We had already indicated that we would go down this line in 1999. The ECJ then subsequently, in the Schindler case, moved into the direction of Menarini, but that was limited to the review of the fines, not to the review of the decision in substance. And here we have another interesting situation, because the General Court seems now to be on our side. They have cited this Norway Post in 20 judgments, and three rather prominent advocate general, Kokkod, Vatale and Megozzi, also referred to Norway Post, and so did the two Swiss federal courts, the Federal Supreme Court and the Federal Administrative Court. Now, my third last, I can skip one if the time is running out. No, I'm giving the sign that I can go on. My next case concerns the transfer of relevant information to the consumer via a website, a very topical issue. In Liechtenstein, an insurance company said, we don't give our customers a hard copy contract anymore. They can have a section of our website where their contract is deposited, and then they can access this section of our website and print this out. So the question asked was asked here whether relevant information to the consumer can be transported via a website. And the EFTA court in this Inconsult case said basically yes, if it is a, I cannot read that.
10 minutes.
If it is a sophisticated website, that means if it is secured that the provider cannot unilaterally change the content, and if it is secured that the content will be there also for a certain time after the expiry of the contract. That means we implied that the consumer can be expected to make a minimal effort, such as a mouse click or the opening of a zip file. A few years later, the ECJ decided in the content services case, following its advocate general, that under European law, the consumer may remain totally passive. The information must be transported to the consumer in a way so that he or she can remain totally passive. I have doubts whether in the internet age this is a model which will survive. German Supreme Court seems to be on the line of the ECJ, but the Austrian Supreme Court seems rather to be on the line of the EFTA court on this. With regard to the concept of private attorney general, which is an American concept, the EFTA court has sided with American legal thinking and said a private plaintiff who is claiming damages for antitrust infringement does not only pursue his private interest, but also contributes to the protection of the public interest and thereby benefits the consumers. And here we have an interesting consolation, because one Advocate General, Cocotte, has followed us in the Corning case. We have then subsequently cited her also again. You know, this is the way of building up now here an alliance, a small alliance. And the General Court in two cases has also followed us, Akzo Nobel and Evonik Degussa, but the ECJ does not. So we will see what the final outcome is of this. Then I come to the too big to fail case. And you, Professor, you asked me about this case. This is the IceSave case. In 2008, all the Icelandic banks went bankrupt, and Landsbanki had two internet branches, one in the UK and one in the Netherlands. And the Deposit Guarantee Fund of Iceland, which is a fund set up by the banks, was not able to pay for those deposits in the UK and in the Netherlands. And so the respective authorities stepped in because they wanted to avoid a bank run. And after diplomatic negotiations between the Icelanders and the Brits and the Dutch had failed, because the state president of Iceland scheduled two referenda, and these agreements which had been negotiated were rejected by the Icelandic population, the Efta Surveillance Authority brought a lawsuit against Iceland and claimed that if all else fails, then the government must pay. The Icelandic government must pay. We were talking about a lot of money. That's a tiny country, you know, 320,000 people. And we were talking about 4 to 6 billion euros. And we found in this case that there is no statutory basis in the respective directive for the liability of the state if a deposit guarantee scheme is unable to pay in a systemic crisis. The Commission had made an intervention on the side of ESA in order to make it clear that the Union expected us to rule against Iceland here. So we would argue in a strictly legal way here, but we added a policy paragraph or two. This is a paragraph 167, and one may call it, from an academic standpoint, a golden paragraph. We said that recital 16 in the preamble of this directive states that deposit insurance, I quote, might in certain cases have the effect of encouraging the unsound management of credit institutions, end of quote. And we said this points to the concept of moral hazard. Nobel laureate Joseph Stiglitz described a lesson of moral hazard in the following way. The more and better insurance that is provided against some contingency, the less incentive individuals have to avoid the insured event, because the less they bear the full consequences of their actions. I have to admit here, you know, moral hazard as a legal figure has, to my extent, never been used in European case law so far. I was the judge rapporteur in this case. I have to admit that I had an advantage because my wife, who is sitting here, has some decades ago written her doctoral thesis on moral hazard. She's an economist. Now, sometimes it's also coincidence which may play a role in real life. The International Center for Ethics, Justice and Public Life at Brandeis University in the U.S. took up this quotation of Stiglitz and said, the so-called ICSAVE judgment is notable in being the first in the history of the European Court of regional integration to reference academic literature. She's certainly right on that, but in all humbleness, I think the judgment is not only notable because of that. The judgment has been commented upon positively in the English financial press, although the British lost a lot of money here. But it has also been criticized. And one of the critiques of this judgment wrote under the pseudonym of Bartolus. He said that in a later case, the ECJ had powerfully and sternly rebuked the EFTA court judgment. He referred to this Hogan case and so on. and said the EFTA Court is taught a lesson on how to interpret the law and hand down a coherent judgment. First of all, this Hogan case had nothing to do with our facts at all. And secondly, I suspect that I know who this Bartolus is. It may be one of the guys who pleaded in the case and lost the case. So you know that Bartolus was the most famous lawyer of the Middle Ages, and Bartolus then also became a prominent figure in the operas, for instance, Il Barbiere, a un dottor della mia sorte, queste scuse, signorina. Meanwhile, Advocate General Mengozzi of the ECJ has positively referenced the ISAFE ruling, including the part on moral hazard in the Surmax case. And with this, ladies and gentlemen, I come to the end of my presentation, and I have some conclusions. I don't have them in writing because I wrote them after having sent the slides here, so I have to have a look myself. First point, EA homogeneity has evolved over these 22 years from one-way street homogeneity on the books to dialogue homogeneity in action. I'm not claiming that we are having the upper hand, generally speaking, but at the end of the day, I think the EFTA Court has positioned itself in quite a positive way in this dialogue. And from snapshot homogeneity, we have to move to the concept of process-oriented homogeneity. And in Espacio Económico de América Latina, the two pillars would have to be on equal footing in any case. Dialogue would be very important. Soft mechanisms would be important, such as convergence. And then something which American commentators have described as the judge's Wanderlust, which is a German word. That means that judges have to see each other. That if there were these two pillars, the Mercosur judges and the Andean judges would have to get together on a regular basis in order to establish also these soft factors of homogeneity. And the question is then, who would be the actors in a future Espacio Económico? That's not for me to answer, but probably you can take this up in the discussion. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you so much,
Josh. Pues agradecemos muchísimo al juez Baden-Baker esta presentación tan interesante de la conferencia Los dos pilares de el sistema europeo, que son la Unión Europea y la Asociación Europea de Libre Comercio, y la idea de tener un sistema similar en Latinoamérica. Ahora, para dar pie a los siguientes ponentes, tendrán, por favor, 10 minutos máximo para vertir sus opiniones en este tema. Cedemos la palabra, por favor, al doctor Rodolfo Cruz Miramontes. Adelante, muchas gracias.
Muchas gracias. Primero, por esta oportunidad de participar en esta reunión tan interesante, donde hemos recibido en unos 40 o 45 minutos un baño entero de derecho europeo. Esto es sumamente interesante para la, pues, la formación, la participación y la solidificación de los movimientos integracionistas que están sucediendo en el mundo y para México en particular, porque hemos tenido nosotros desde 1991 una presencia muy activa, señor juez, en los procesos de integración. Hemos celebrado, a resultas de una consulta que se hizo al Senado en el año de 1990, acuerdos de libre comercio, de establecimiento de zonas de libre comercio hasta ahora nada más, con de América del Norte, con Canadá y Estados Unidos. Posteriormente, como usted lo sabe, celebramos un acuerdo sumamente rico, interesantísimo, con la Unión Europea. Y luego hemos seguido, yo califico esto como un tobogán de acuerdos, en donde la política de comercio exterior de México, siendo proteccionista y cerrada, se abrió, nos alocamos, valga la expresión, y nos pusimos a celebrar muchos acuerdos. Sin embargo, yo considero que el TLCAN y un acuerdo que acaba de terminar de negociarse el 5 de octubre pasado, o sea, a la vuelta de la esquina, el Trans-Pacific Partnership, TPP, como le llamamos, son acuerdos clave, son acuerdos que marcan hitos en la historia y en la consolidación, de alguna manera, de fenómenos de integración. Este acuerdo del TPP es un acuerdo celebrado con 12 países, de los cuales casi la mitad, poco más, están ubicados en la cuenca del Pacífico y los otros en América Latina. En ellos, yo he participado activamente como representante de sectores productivos mexicanos de la parte particular, es decir, no como funcionario público, y he insistido mucho en que se haga un capítulo específico, se elabore un acuerdo específico en relación con la solución de controversias, en donde sea el arbitraje el que resuelva por su valor, no me meto en ello ya, el tiempo es muy limitado, la importancia de ello. En consecuencia, puedo decirle a usted que en esto y en lo otro que hemos venido haciendo, además, la consolidación de algunos de estos acuerdos de libre comercio en bloque. Teníamos unos con los pequeños países de Centroamérica y consolidamos esto en un acuerdo ya único con Centroamérica. Acabamos de hacer una cosa similar de la Alianza del Pacífico, le llamamos, con 4 países, con Colombia, con Perú, con Chile y México. Y es un constituye, pues, de hecho, un bloque sumamente interesante, valioso e importante. Y en todos ellos, bueno, yo he participado, como digo, he insistido mucho en la presencia de esas cláusulas de solución de controversias. Existen y están presentes. En consecuencia, esto alienta a tener la certeza de que, bueno, en lo posible, pues, de que la fortificación del Estado de Derecho y el camino trazado a partir de la Comunidad Económica Europea con todos sus derivados, que usted también nos ha explicado, ya no menciono ninguno, es el camino a seguir pese a los golpeteos que actualmente se están viviendo a partir del 2008. Pero creo que, espero que salgamos bien de ello en este gran experimento y con ello a la fortaleza, pues, de nuestra disciplina del derecho como presencia única para que podamos tener paz y tranquilidad. Muchas gracias y agradezco la presencia de la señora embajadora de Noruega, que es poco común tener aquí gentes tan distinguidas, al digno representante de la Embajada de Suiza y algunos funcionarios de las embajadas. Qué bueno que están aquí y los estudiantes, desde luego. Muchísimas gracias, señora.
Agradecemos al doctor Rodolfo Cruz Miramontes y si bien es cierto México ya tiene el andamiaje en materia económica e integracionista, lo que nos falta es el gran brinco a esa Asociación Europea de Libre Comercio con un tribunal específico. El arbitraje ya está, necesitamos ese tribunal que genera las condiciones que mencionaba el juez Bodenbacher, que tiene que ver con jueces calificados, independencia, imparcialidad, sin agenda política, con competencia y con escrutinio. Ese es el reto de América Latina. Lo otro ya está dado, hay que superar ese evento y le agradecemos mucho sus palabras, doctor Rodolfo Cruz Miramontes. Seguimos con la agenda y le damos la palabra, 10 minutos, por favor, al doctor Sergio Peña Neira. Adelante, por favor, doctor.
Sí, mi primera palabra de agradecimiento por la oportunidad de estar aquí en esta presentación que ha hecho el profesor doctor Karl Baudenbacher, que es además juez de la EFTA Court. Para mí ha sido un gusto poder escuchar su presentación. Había tenido la oportunidad de leerla ayer. Y obviamente la propuesta de él es una propuesta extremadamente interesante y en cierto sentido revolucionaria. Por cuanto nosotros con bastante trabajo hemos logrado, y cuando digo nosotros me refiero a los latinoamericanos, desde mediados del siglo pasado hemos logrado ir consolidando ciertos procesos de integración. Uno de ellos, al cual se refirió el profesor Baudenbacher, es el caso del Pacto Andino, en el cual, en mi caso, mi país, yo soy chileno, tuvo especial participación, aunque posteriormente se retiró. Y otro es el tema del Mercosur, en el cual hemos tenido, de alguna manera, acercamientos para poder participar propiamente, ya sea como país asociado, y posteriormente trabajar, digamos, ya como país integrante. Ahora bien, contar con un tribunal de este tipo, es decir, un tribunal que solamente se refiera al tema comercial internacional, no cabe duda que podría ser muy, muy interesante desde el punto de vista de la especialización en cuanto al conocimiento de las materias y en particular, además, en la solución de los conflictos. Porque, perdón, lamentablemente, si bien tenemos el arbitraje, y el arbitraje ha producido una serie de sentencias muy interesantes, tanto a nivel nacional como también en los tribunales europeos, en París, particularmente de la Cámara de Comercio Internacional, la permanencia y la posibilidad de independencia por parte de los jueces que pudieran participar o ser miembros del tribunal podría auxiliarnos mucho para el desarrollo de el derecho internacional comercial y, por cierto, el derecho comercial internacional en Iberoamérica. Nosotros hemos tenido un desarrollo acerca del tema, más bien a través de tratados internacionales, en donde se ha incluido necesariamente el tema del arbitraje como una forma de solución de conflicto. Contamos con algunas dificultades y sobre eso me gustaría hacer solamente los siguientes alcances. Una primera dificultad es la aplicación de la sentencia extranjera a nivel nacional. Y en ese sentido me gustaría que el profesor Baudenbacher nos pudiera ilustrar, si es tan amable, no sé si entiende mi castellano bien, nos pudiera ilustrar cómo es el proceso, porque él mismo ha señalado que no tiene efecto directo, como ocurre con la Corte Europea de Justicia, que sus fallos son o tienen efecto directo. Siempre me acuerdo de Van Gender en Luz, de Costa versus Enel, etcétera, esa sentencia, y que provocaron un revuelo bastante grande a nivel nacional. En segundo lugar, me gustaría saber cómo ustedes han desarrollado otro proceso que también es tremendamente importante, de la imparcialidad de los jueces y de su trabajo en cuanto a la elección de los mismos, porque si este es o fuera un tribunal, digamos, latinoamericano, creo que no necesariamente no podríamos tener tres jueces. Sería muy interesante un número tan pequeño, pero yo creo que todos los países mirarían la posibilidad de poder tener al menos un juez. Es una cuestión de lógica. Y en tercer lugar, también dentro del proceso estructural, ¿cómo es que ustedes han desarrollado necesariamente dentro de sus países, los países miembros del EFTA, obviamente, el proceso de aplicación de las sentencias que se dictan? Entendí todo lo que es el proceso de interpretación y me pareció muy interesante el principio de la efectividad, que quizás dentro del ámbito comercial internacional es plausiblemente aplicable, porque necesariamente se trata de sujetos de derechos nacionales, pero que tienen un trabajo dentro del ámbito interestatal, ¿ya? Entre estados. Podrían ser, por supuesto, organismos del Estado que tuvieran relación con otros organismos del Estado o con organismos privados. Y hay una pregunta que también me gustaría señalar, y que es otra pregunta final, si me permite, de esta muy interesante exposición. Si no, no haría preguntas en general, pero me permito, después de la exposición del profesor Cruz Miramonte, que fue muy ilustrativa, ¿cómo es que ustedes pueden evitar caer en un problema que todos nos preguntamos, o muchos de los que hemos pensado este tema, nos preguntamos? Nosotros tenemos una corte o un tribunal en Iberoamérica que trabaja el tema de la inversión extranjera. Entonces, podríamos encontrarnos, algo que estuvimos conversando hace un momento atrás, anteriormente, con una situación de overlapping, es decir, de competencia que pudiera generar algún tipo de dificultad entre ambos tribunales. Les agradezco enormemente nuevamente a la UNAM por la oportunidad de estar acá, al profesor Manuel Becerra, a la profesora Liliana Rodríguez y la oportunidad de estar frente o al lado a tan distinguidos miembros y por supuesto al profesor Baudenbach.
Muchas gracias. Bueno, siempre se dice que el método socrático es el mejor, que nazcan más preguntas que respuestas. Y esperaríamos entonces que el juez Bodenbacher nos las contestara en el momento en que los estudiantes también formulen sus preguntas. Solo alguna observación. No reducir el ejercicio de las cortes en materia económica al tema económico. Hoy no se pueden desvincular los efectos de la economía en los derechos humanos. En una parte de la presentación del juez, en el tema de convergencia institucional, él habló de inversiones y derechos humanos. Y si pensamos bien, el caso Kellogg, que él mencionó sobre el principio de precaución, tiene que ver con un impacto del consumo al ser humano, que al final es derecho al alimento, que es un derecho humano. Entonces, no podemos aislar las consecuencias de los temas económicos, de los temas de derechos humanos, que cada vez están más imbricados. Vamos a darle la palabra, por favor, al doctor Tomás Milton Muñoz. Adelante, doctor, por favor.
Muchas gracias. Particularmente debo de iniciar agradeciendo tanto la invitación del doctor Manuel Becerra Ramírez, así como la exposición brillante del doctor Bodenbacher. Me está fallando un poquito la voz, así es que espero me disculpen por ello. Agradezco también al Instituto de Investigaciones Jurídicas por la oportunidad de estar aquí. Desde mi lado, desde la ciencia política, desde las relaciones internacionales, hay que hacer una revisión de lo que son los procesos. Y la idea que el doctor Bodenbacher propone es provocadora. Desde que tuve la oportunidad de leer precisamente su ponencia, también el día de ayer, resulta provocador porque señala, ¿se puede exportar a final de cuentas el modelo del acuerdo de área económica de Europa, América Latina? Y bueno, tenemos que dividirlo básicamente en dos situaciones. Por una parte, este acuerdo ha permitido a Europa, a buena parte de los países de Europa, resolver sus diferencias comerciales para avanzar, a pesar de que no todos estén integrados en la Unión Europea, que eso es bien importante y lo debo destacar. Regularmente cuando nosotros visualizamos a Europa, pensamos únicamente en la Unión Europea. Y recordemos, en materia de integración, no todos los países de Europa se encuentran en esta institución. Y en materia comercial, tienen que resolver una serie de diferencias y qué mejor, a final de cuentas, como un modelo que ya describió el doctor, que fue muy importante, pero pudo, a final de cuentas, producir una serie de resultados a corto, mediano y a largo plazo, particularmente por cuatro situaciones. Uno, es producto de una serie de instituciones fuertes en la Unión Europea que se han ido constituido poco a poco, pero que existen como tal. Número dos, una cesión parcial de soberanía por parte de los países integrantes de estos acuerdos, cosa a la que en América Latina todavía somos muy renuentes a esta reducción de la soberanía. Tres, las simetrías. A final de cuentas, en el caso de la Unión Europea, de Europa en general, después de la Segunda Guerra Mundial, había más simetrías que diferencias, y esto permitía, a final de cuentas, tener una negociación de pares. En el caso de América Latina, eso, por desgracia, no ocurre necesariamente. Y finalmente, esta parte comercial, que es importantísima desde el punto de vista de la integración, en Europa ha permitido permear en otros niveles, en el social, en el político, incluso hasta en el cultural, para tener una serie de políticas comunes. Esto, insisto, a raíz primero de lo comercial, después pasado por lo legal, insisto, lo político, lo cultural. Y he ahí por eso la gran aportación de esta exposición, provocarnos y señalar que a pesar de estas diferencias, en el caso de América Latina, tenemos que suplir una serie de retos, además de los ya mencionados entre ellos, que hay una serie de asimetrías muy fuertes en los diferentes integrantes de América Latina y el Caribe. Hay que superar algo particularmente muy preocupante. Hay diferentes modelos de integración en América Latina, muchos de ellos son disímbolos, y es por eso que vemos una serie de mecanismos que no tienen entre sí una serie de conexiones que permitan tener un mejor comercio internacional. Menciono solamente algunos de estos modelos económicos divergentes. En el caso de México, ya lo mencionamos, Tratado de Libre Comercio de América del Norte, también el acuerdo de el acuerdo de la Alianza del Pacífico, que son muy concatenados a lo que es la lógica de Estados Unidos. En Sudamérica, por el contrario, particularmente vemos dos modelos de integración comerciales, sobre todo hoy en día con una serie de problemas, porque incluso los flujos comerciales han disminuido, que es el Mercosur, la Comunidad Andina de Naciones. Y bueno, podríamos seguir con una lista interminable, por ejemplo, CARICOM, podríamos hablar incluso de nuevos procesos de integración políticos como la Comunidad de Estados Latinoamericanos y del Caribe. Así es que en ese sentido, y con esto cierro, es la gran aportación a final de cuentas de esta magnífica exposición. No hablar de un neocolonialismo, es decir, de importar específicamente un modelo a la realidad de América Latina como tal, no, sino ver en otros modelos caminos que nos permitan a final de cuentas tener una serie de sinergias que nos permitan resolver problemas comunes. Y recordemos, a final de cuentas, el modelo económico imperante en el día de hoy, y probablemente en varias décadas más, es el libre comercio. Y en ese sentido, si hablamos de una integración latinoamericana, pues definitivamente nos hacen falta muchos pasos y muchos modelos a analizar para tener, insisto, mejores reglas comerciales que no solamente beneficien el comercio, sino también, como señalaban de manera previa, también el respeto a los derechos humanos. Muchas gracias.
Agradecemos mucho la interpretación del doctor Milton, a quien le agradecemos la aportación del tema de soberanía, que es un aspecto importante en este continente, y por supuesto el tema de las asimetrías que difícilmente genera esa complementariedad económica tan buscada. Cedemos la palabra al organizador e impulsor de este tipo de eventos, al doctor Manuel Becerra. Adelante, Manuel, por favor.
Muchísimas gracias. En principio quiero agradecer al Instituto de Investigaciones Jurídicas y a su director que haya hecho posible que se realizara esta mesa redonda tan rápida realmente, pero tan atractiva. Cuando se nos hizo la invitación para organizar en el instituto, dijimos es muy poco tiempo, pero al mismo tiempo es muy atractivo, y ahora me doy cuenta de que hicimos bien. Quiero, por supuesto, agradecer a la embajadora de Noruega en México, al representante de la embajada suiza en México, también de ayudarnos a la organización del evento. ¿Qué es lo que puedo decir rápidamente, sin ser reconociendo que no soy un experto, pero conozco un poco América Latina? A mí me parece que el tribunal, que es la parte central de la exposición del presidente de la Corte, está en la creación de un tribunal de ese tipo. Indudablemente, y me parece que es la opinión de la mesa, no hay duda que es muy atractivo tener un tribunal de estas características. Y luego con las sentencias que se han dictado, son impresionantemente trascendentes y que me hacen pensar que en un modelo de organización europea donde hay diferentes culturas de carácter jurídico, la anglosajona por una parte y la de el derecho continental germano romano, pueda hacer posible la existencia de un tribunal de esas características. A mí me parece que viendo el modelo y las sentencias que se han dictado, es algo así como un libre comercio con cara humana, sobre todo por la inclusión de los derechos humanos. Y ya les digo, las sentencias que son bastante atractivas, habría que ver, simplemente estudiar con mucha calma las sentencias en el caso de ISAVE, que es impresionante, tiene una gran trascendencia. Esa es mi premisa mayor, es indudable, es interesantísimo. Ahora bien, la práctica latinoamericana es un tanto diferente. Y después voy a regresar un tanto con el tribunal. Diferentes modelos de libre comercio en América Latina, en donde tal parece que son bloques de carácter comercial dentro mismo continente. Sería fabuloso tener una corte de este estilo que tratara de emparejar las diferencias. Me temo que muchas de estas bloques de carácter comercial están asentados en modelos de carácter ideológico, inclusive. Eso hace muy difícil en América Latina crear una organización de este tipo. Pensando simplemente con el TPP o con el Mercomún. El TPP indudablemente es un elemento que va a dar un gran impacto en América Latina, pero fundamentalmente los que son parte, como saben, estarían los países de América del Norte, por otra parte Perú y Chile en este momento, que al mismo tiempo, y por supuesto todos los países de Asia, de Pacífico, por supuesto que este es un modelo bastante interesante, no quiero decir ni atractivo ni malo, para juzgarlo en otro momento con mayor tiempo y más dedicación, mayor profundidad, pero que definitivamente tiene una tendencia de carácter un tanto ideológico comercial. Se está hablando, y eso lo dijo el presidente de los Estados Unidos, es un acuerdo que trata de cerrar las puertas a China. Y por otra parte, hay que tomar en cuenta que en el Mercosur también hay una tendencia hacia la comercialización con China. Y también está el modelo de Mercosur. Es decir, me parece que sería atractivo una corte con este tipo, porque precisamente una de las bases es hacer a un lado la cuestión de carácter ideológico y ver el libre comercio junto con derechos humanos. Pero yo plantearía la realidad de América Latina, ¿daría posibilidades a un tribunal de estas características? Lo ideal es que sí. La posibilidad, no sé. Por otra parte, yo rescataría también el análisis del tribunal. A mí me parece que a nivel de estudiosos nosotros de otros tipos de tribunales, y tomando en cuenta precisamente la corriente que hay en América Latina con la Corte Interamericana de Derechos Humanos, donde la jurisprudencia cada vez es más importante, sería cuestión también de ver la jurisprudencia de una corte de este tipo. Y eso será cuestión de hablar con el señor presidente, que habrá un espacio a los estudiantes y estudiosos de la universidad para hacer estancias de investigación en el tribunal. Pues es una cosa que vamos a hablar con el presidente. Muchas gracias.
Gracias. ¿Cuántos minutos? Bueno, ahora abriremos el micrófono a los estudiantes, a los embajadores, a los profesores que están aquí, y en lo que van formulando sus preguntas, recibiremos tres, dado el tiempo. Pueden formularlas en inglés o en español, como deseen. Y en tanto deciden quién, le pediríamos al juez Bodenbacher si podría, por favor, tratar de dar respuestas a las preguntas que el panel ha planteado. Muchas gracias, señor juez.
Yes, certainly. Should I? I'm sorry. I was just given a beautiful book by Professor Cruz Miramonte, so I was distracted. Okay. A lot of questions have been raised, and I'm grateful for these questions. I just go over some of them. Professor Peñanera, you spoke about direct effect and the lack of direct effect in EFTA. It is not such a big problem. You know, I am a Swiss citizen, although I'm the judge on behalf of the Principality of Liechtenstein, and I have been brought up in a monist system. And sometimes I have even difficulties to understand my Nordic friends when it comes to that, who are very thin-skinned when you use the term of monism. However, the EEA agreement as such has been implemented into the national legal orders of the member states. That means, with regard to EEA agreement, the question of direct effect does not really pose itself anymore. The same goes for the largest part of secondary legislation of the directives and of the regulations. There have been cases in which the lack of direct effect has been a problem, but one should not forget that we have adopted state liability in the EEA, in the EFTA pillar. That was very controversial at the time, whether state liability, which in the European Union is linked to the names of Frankovic and Bonifaci and Brasserie du Pêcheur, was very controversial at the time. And the Norwegian government, the Icelandic government, and the Swedish government, which feared liabilities from its time in EEA EFTA, spoke up against it. And even the European Commission didn't want us to go for state liability for, I'm not sure for what reasons. I sometimes said that the Commission seems to think that these are toys only the European Union people can play with, and we EFTA guys should not play with these toys. I label this a Toys R Us approach. Be that as it may, we approved state liability, and this has resolved many problems. I cannot see that my court would go for direct effect in the foreseeable future, because that would hurt the feelings of our Nordic member states way too much. But I may remind that in the court's very first case, the Commission came and said, you should now recognize direct effect, full stop, as the ECJ did in Van Grinden Loos. You also mentioned that we are only three judges. Well, that is the way it is. We are three member states, and so we have three judges. And a lot of commentators who did not like us have tried to belittle us because of that by saying, oh, they are only three, that's small, they have no power. In the meantime, I think with the complexity which is to be feared now, in particular in the General Court of the European Union, which is going to have 56 judges in the near future, it becomes very, very difficult to maintain the coherence of the case law. And as I said, we are quick. We render a preliminary ruling in between 7 and 8 months. So it also has its advantages. As far as the implementation of our judgments in the member states is concerned, infringement judgments are being implemented. Acciones de incumplimiento is the term in Spanish. These judgments are being implemented. In one or two cases, they were not immediately implemented, and then we give a second judgment in which we sentence the country in question, but it's not a major problem. A problem has been whether our preliminary rulings are being implemented by the courts in the member states, because those preliminary rulings, according to the text of the surveillance and court agreement, are only advisory in nature. They are referred to as advisory opinions. And so the strict, the fierce dualists have claimed from the beginning it is crystal clear that they do not bind the national courts. However, the text is only one element of interpretation. There are also other elements. And in particular, the homogeneity goal is always there. So if a national court refuses to follow us on a certain interpretation, they put homogeneity at stake. And we could now talk for hours about this as a theoretical concept. What counts at the end of the day is whether there is an authority suing the respective state in case the National Supreme Court does not comply. And we are having such a case right now. My court has given judgment in a case involving the posting of workers abroad, where it was about certain collective agreements, and we held that certain clauses in these collective agreements were in violation of European law, and the Norwegian Supreme Court did not follow us on that, openly deviated from this. And now, for the first time in the history of the EEA, the EFTA Surveillance Authority has taken up this case and has opened infringement proceedings against Norway. That's a very sensitive area, I understand it, not only politically, because labor unions are strong in Norway, but also because for the first time, ESA has now said, even if there is no written obligation to follow, you have to maintain homogeneity. And if you do not maintain homogeneity, this may amount to an infringement. We will see how this case goes. But generally speaking, I can say that in the early years, clearly, it was a fight because, I mean, the court was new and everybody said, we love this court, but they thought as long as they sentence the others, we love them. When they sentence us, we do not love them so much. But over these 20 years, I think we have gained quite some recognition, and we worked also on gaining recognition, for instance, by using a style of reasoning which is much more comprehensive than the ECJ's style of reasoning. If you are only three, you cannot decree what the law is. You know, you have to justify your holding by giving good reasons. And we took a couple of other measures in order to be recognized. The point of an immigration court, well, Europe is forced with the issue of immigration quite clearly. It is in the hands of the normal courts. Human rights may come into the play here. My court is not bound by the Charter of Human Rights of the European Union. The Charter is not even part of the EA agreement because the EFTA states were not part of those who negotiated the Charter. The EFTA states are all members of the European Human Rights Convention. And so in the case of the European Human Rights Convention, we said we interpret EA law in the light of the Human Rights Convention. Basically, we are there like ECJ. With regard to the Charter, it's much more sensitive. We had a spring seminar. The EFTA Court holds a spring seminar every year with some 120 people where this was discussed and where a lot of public international law professors and political scientists said, you cannot do that, you are stealing the sovereignty. And we said, let's cross the bridge when we come to it. You know, one guy was there, a former judge of the European Court of Human Rights, who said to us, I give you good advice. If you face the problem, you just apply the Charter without quoting it. I'm not saying that we would go down this road, but it is an open question. I would like to add that during these first 20 years, we have seen an academic and political discussion in EFTA, which pretty much limited itself to questions of constitution, of legitimacy, of institutions. Most of the professors and the politicians always jumped on effect, jumped on state liability, jumped of ultra vires and so on. And a couple of weeks ago, I was invited to give a talk at the University of Oslo, and I gave this talk under the title, Dealing with the EEA Agreement, Where is the Beef? You know, where is the beef is this American expression? Where is the substance? Where is the content? And I think after 20 years, we now must focus on the rights of individuals and economic operators, on the benefits for them, and not on sovereignty. You know, sovereignty is a vast concept. It's a black box in a way. Nobody knows exactly whether that comprises the prerogatives of certain high civil servants or certain national judges. So I think that the focus should now more be on what's in for the individuals, also from a human rights perspective. Finally, Professor Milton, you mentioned these four points, and I can, with great interest, I have listened to you. My impression is, with all respect, but with all these different treaties you have in Latin America, with change in membership here, it's a bit messy. It's a bit messy, and this is not really what enhances legal certainty. An organization which could be the roof of such a two-pillar model would be UNASUR, but not, I'm not sufficiently familiar with the Latin American situation so that I could talk about it. Thank you very much.
Público, alguien, si levanta la mano para que le aproximen el micrófono, por favor, muchas gracias.
Thank you very much, Professor, for your exposition. It was very interesting. I was wondering, like, you were talking about a lot about the homogeneity and the necessity that you had in Europe so that these courts could be made. And I think we have in Latin America a lot of homogeneity in terms of language, in terms of culture, in terms of background and history. So it would be like very natural for us to achieve this type of tribunal. However, we haven't done so. And I was wondering, if one of the reasons, well, personally, I think maybe one of the reasons is like the political agendas that unfortunately every time a government changes in Latin America, they change the agenda. And whatever had been achieved or done before or previously sometimes get lost. So I was wondering, like, if maybe besides of the political culture that we have, could it be also the territoriality? I mean, the territory is much more extensive than the territory in Europe, and maybe I think that has helped Europe to be more united, to feel more united. And I don't know if this is one of our barriers. What would you think? Thank you.
Thank you very much for this question. It's difficult for me to comment on why it is so difficult in Latin America. I was encouraged by President Díaz-Canseco to focus on this project, but I need input from Latin Americans in order to understand this continent better. My impression is that it would be difficult for Latin America to set up a two-pillar system with strict obligations and hard law. That's why I would think that convergence would be a good mechanism. Talking to each other, seeing each other. I mean, judges have all university degrees and are all highly educated people, and they should be able to listen to rational argument and not to populistic arguments. If you speak about the politicians, we can see what's going on here. But you shouldn't forget that we also have populists in Europe, and it's not that easy anymore. The times when everybody was convinced that European integration would move forward all the time are probably over. Whether Europe had an advantage in that its countries are not as big, I leave that open. I mean, the Germans and the French think that they are rather big countries, although if you compare them to the rest of the world, it's probably not true. But in fact, I think one of the most amazing accomplishments of European integration is that at the end of the day, it does not count whether you come from a small country or from a large country. And here I take, on the one hand, the example of Luxembourg. Luxembourg is tiny, has 500,000 inhabitants, and yet they have always been able to produce big minds. A handful of big minds is sufficient, who played a crucial role in the institutions of the European Union, and it is so until today. And at the same time, I would like to mention now EFTA. If you look at the geographic situation in the EFTA pillar, with Norway up there and Iceland in the middle of the Atlantic, half American, geographically speaking, there's the continental rift, and tiny Liechtenstein somewhere in the mountains. It is amazing that this has worked so well. And it is quite clear that those who pay a lot from time to time, in particular the politicians, think that they should have more rights. But on balance, this has worked out fine, and the Norwegians have accepted the law as the tiny Liechtenstein has had to accept the law. I think that is a very big accomplishment.
Gracias. ¿Alguien más quiere formular alguna pregunta? Bueno, pues agradecemos mucho su presencia y les pediría ponerse de pie para hacer entrega del testimonio al juez Bodenbacher, que nos honra con su presencia. Agradecer a su esposa Doris, que ha hecho un viaje muy largo para acompañarlo. Estamos muy agradecidos y hacemos entrega de un reconocimiento al juez Carl Bodenbacher. Muchísimas gracias por su presencia, señor juez.
Gracias.
Thank you very much, but I do want to do.
This is the Festschrift which has been published on the occasion of the 20th anniversary of the EFTA Accord last December.
And right now is my...
Yes, I will write something.
Thank you very much.
Muchas gracias a todos por su presencia. Agradecemos la presencia de la señora embajadora, del representante de Suiza, al juez, a los ponentes que nos acompañan. Y a nombre del Anuario Mexicano de Derecho Internacional, del doctor Manuel Becerra, que lo dirige, hacemos entrega de esta revista, esperando que tenga oportunidad de participar en el anuario.
Muchas gracias.
Gracias, Manuel, por tu compañía y a todos buenas tardes.
Muchas gracias.